All right, it's good day again, and welcome back to our Monday plenary. We are, as they say, live to tape. So if you want to review this lecture later, you'll be able to do so on YouTube. I hope everybody's well today and ready to get going with Thomas Hobbes, a very important and influential philosopher. So we've had a pretty good look at Plato and Aristotle the last couple of weeks in the reverse order. And that gave us a handle also on the ancient world and its view of ethics and justice, notwithstanding the dissimilarities between Plato and Aristotle. They were of the same age, the same era, and they had, of course, some similar views as well as disparities. We're going to fast forward now quite a number of centuries back to the early moderns. We looked at Descartes and his epistemology in the first part of the course, and Descartes and Hobbes were contemporaries. So I want to give you a little bit of a setup before we tackle Hobbes's ethics and then eventually from that, his theory of justice. Hobbes's influence continues to this day. He's generally regarded as the founder of two fields, one that is not so much in use and the other which is very much important in our times. The first field that he's credited with having founded is called empirical psychology. You probably won't find a course on empirical psychology in the psychology department because that term has been outmoded by many other kinds of developments in the field of psychology, in the discipline rather of psychology. Nonetheless, what empirical psychology means, that pursuit of trying to understand human nature by observing people and how they behave. So Hobbes, like Descartes, is an early scientist, although he called himself a philosopher. There were no scientists at that time. But Hobbes was a very keen observer of human beings and of our social interactions and our political process. And he was caught up in a very bad thing, which he lived through and then wrote about, called the English Civil War. And this made him even a closer observer than he wanted to be of human nature and so forth. And so he's doing what we today call, or what we used to call, empirical psychology, because many of his theories, which pertain not only to human nature, but inevitably to ethics and justice, are derived from his observations of the people and societies in which he was immersed in his time. He lived to 91. Wrote a lot, remained lucid to the end, is quite a controversial figure, and one in whom I think you'll find some grounds for agreement and possibly disagreement. The other field that he's credited with founding, and there's very little dispute about that, is modern political philosophy. So his Leviathan, which is the name of the seminal work from which we'll be looking at certain extracts in the next 2 days, today and Thursday, at least, in my group, the Leviathan is really the first work of modern political philosophy, and it differs quite a bit from its ancient predecessors because Hobbes lived in a much different time. Okay, so that's a bit about Hobbes. Just as a run-up, I'm going to give a little bit more before we delve into the extracts. His dates are 1588 to 1679. And he was born the year 1588 in English history is quite a momentous year because it was the year of the Spanish Armada. And if you want to understand Hobbes, perhaps it's a good thing to understand a little bit about the history of that time. Not a lot, but a little. You can read up on it more on your own time. But essentially, has anyone heard of the Spanish Armada? Now I'll type in the phrase, just curious. Spanish Armada, so-called, of 1588. An armada is a great flotilla of ships, yes? Yeah, the Navy, right. Armada, it was an invasion force. No, none of you so far, no one's heard of it. Okay, I'm not surprised. It's really more an artifact of English history than American history or world history. But in 1588, the European powers, all of the continental powers in Western Europe were Catholic. That is to say, the monarchs were all Catholic and they all owed allegiance to the Pope. So although the monarchies and empires that grew out of that period were quite powerful, they nonetheless paid allegiance to the Roman popes. And so they were partly theocracies. And England had diverged from this in the ensuing decades, mostly because of Henry VIII. And I'll bet a lot more of you have heard of King Henry VIII for some reason than of the Spanish Armada. Has anyone heard of Henry VIII? Just say yes or no. Yeah, there you go, a bunch of people. So what have you heard? It never ceases to amaze me. Everyone has still heard of King Henry VIII, although his role in this was actually seminal but minor. What do you know about Henry VIII? He made England Protestant. Yes, that's right, more or less, more or less. What Henry VIII, lots of wives. Yes, that's more generally what people know. Multiple marriages, yes, not at the same time, but successively. He had, I think, 8 wives at different times. Some of them lost their heads quite literally. He had fertility issues. Yeah, the excommunication, exactly, Bernard. All those things factor in to 1588. So in brief, Henry VIII had fertility issues. He was the House of Tudor, and he had trouble fathering any children at all. He did, in the end, have one very important daughter who took over the throne from him, namely Queen Elizabeth I. And she was a great queen whose name is synonymous with the Elizabethan age. And that was the age of Shakespeare, 16th century. It was really a very nice age to live in, apparently. But what Henry VIII did to cause all this trouble with the popes was that he needed a divorce. He kept trying to father children and he couldn't. So he kept thinking, well, maybe I need a new wife. So he needed divorces, and the Pope, whichever Pope it was, it wouldn't give him a divorce. And so basically Henry VIII said, well, I'm king, you know, I'm king of England, I can do what I want. So he created his own church. He didn't suppress the Catholic Church. He created the Church of England in order to grant himself a divorce, okay? So he said, well, I'm king, I can create a church. And then I can nominate an archbishop, and that person can grant me a divorce. And that's exactly what he did. So the church was really a vehicle for him, but it was his daughter Elizabeth who made it into a national institution. She's really the one who took it and made it into the Church of England, which of course persists to this day. So are we clear? And it was this act of religious independence from Europe which so antagonized the Pope and the Catholic monarchs that they sought, by 1588, they sought actually to invade England and to conquer England militarily and to restore the Roman Catholic Church. So this was an attempted invasion. And the only time England has been successfully invaded, rather the last time, was 1066 when the Normans conquered it. The Normans conquered the Saxons, more or less. But this big invasion attempt, which was mostly a Spanish fleet, Spain was very powerful at that time and had the biggest empire of all the Western nations, and they had a great navy, and it was full of troops. So a storm blew up in the English Channel, and almost miraculously, the Armada was blown off course, many ships sunk. And also many were blown all the way around Scotland. Some of them landed in Ireland. They were washed up on the beaches, and there are descendants even today in Ireland of the survivors of the Spanish Armada. So England was saved, and that was the year Hobbes was born. And he said in his autobiography that his mother gave birth to him prematurely because of the fright, at the news that the Spanish Armada had sailed. And so he said she gave birth to twins, him and fear. And as we'll see, his philosophy has a lot to do with fear. His political philosophy certainly has a lot to do with fear. So that was an interesting observation on Hobbes's part. Another thing that's very relevant to Hobbes is that he later got caught up in the English Civil War, as I've mentioned to you. And that was not a religious war so much. It was a power struggle between the king and parliament, the different king. When Elizabeth died, the Tudor line ended. And the Stuarts from Scotland were made the kings of England. And King James I was quite famous for the King James Bible. I don't know if any of you have seen or heard of it, but that was part of his legacy. And it was his son, Charles I, who ended up having a problem because he wanted to have more authority than he really had. And he basically suppressed parliaments. and the parliamentarians at that time were clamoring to have more power and more say in taxation and, you know, these usual things that come up in political conflicts. And that precipitated a terrible thing, which was the English Civil War. And Hobbes had to flee, actually. Hobbes was tutoring the king's son at that point, and he fled England with the court. The king's wife was French, a French princess, and they took refuge in Paris while the Civil War raged. But it's a very interesting story. And what Hobbes learned, what about the book Common Sense? Are you talking about Thomas Paine, Thomas Paine's pamphlet? That was, is that what you mean, Hillary? The book Common Sense? Yeah, you got them mixed up for sure, because the American Revolution is still, you know, a long way away. We're talking about the English Civil War of the 17th century. This is not the American Revolution of the 18th century, and not the French Revolution of the 18th century. The point is that Hobbes lived through the Civil War, and what he concluded from his experience in that Civil War was that civil wars were worse than international wars. And the reason is basically that we can end up making peace with countries that we've been at war with, and we can end up having very good relations, economic, political, cultural. We can have wonderful relations internationally with countries that we at one time were at war with. But Hobbes said that civil wars are worse because they persist, and the grievances and the scars really never heal. It's more like a family feud, which, you know, you can make peace with your neighbors, but family feuds tend to go on and can be very ugly. And Hobbes likened civil wars to family feuds, and he thought the problems caused by civil wars are potentially unending. And so his real political quest in the Leviathan, the book we're about to read from, was to tackle the problem of civil war. He wanted to solve the problem of civil war. And arguably he did. I mean, in his own way, he gives us something very useful as a solution to the problem of civil war. The price we pay for civil peace, in Hobbes's view, and in Hobbes's philosophy, is unfortunately going to explain why we still have international conflicts. And that's, you know, one of the fallouts from Hobbes's political theory. It really unfortunately explains, doesn't cause international conflict, but explains why it's so difficult to achieve world peace, why it's possible to achieve a stable state through the prescription that he offers to us for solving civil conflict. But that prescription at the same time almost entails a necessity for great difficulty in resolving international conflicts. And we'll look at that on Thursday in our breakout group. But for the time being, I want to introduce his, first things first, and see how we get into this problem, you know, to begin with. It has to do with our human nature, basically, and Hobbes' theory of human nature, okay? So that's a bit of an introduction to where Hobbes is going. And the other thing I just want to share with you is just a little bit about, again, Hobbes's period and the philosophers of that early modern time who were so essential to breaking free from medieval traditions and ushering in what today we call modernity. But just to bring Hobbes's point into a contemporary context, just look at the examples of World War II, where we had a terrible conflict with Germany and Japan. And after World War II ended, they became tremendous political allies, economic allies, cultural allies. We've had great trade relations with them, diplomatic relations with them. Yes, and all that stuff from World War II is more or less past and been replaced with extremely convivial relations between the USA, and not only the USA, but all the allied countries. And Germany and Japan are viewed as friends, notwithstanding the terrible conflicts that we had. Yes, exactly right. You're from Poland, Julia says, and they destroyed. Yeah, I mean, Poland was torn to pieces by the Nazis and the communists, but now you're big allies. Sure, economic allies. So that's what Hobbes is saying, that international conflicts can get resolved, and moreover, can get resolved to everyone's advantage. Same with England in the Revolutionary War, big time, Monticello. I mean, England was desperately trying to win the War of Independence here. They didn't want America to break away at all, and it was very contentious, and there was a lot of hatred Not every Englishman. There were many liberals in England who approved, but there was a huge military effort, and we very nearly lost the Revolutionary War, as you know. It was a close thing. And so now England and the U.S. are probably the two strongest allies in the West. Historically, ever since, we've become closer and closer. And, you know, the Anglo-American alliance is amazingly strong and mutually favorable and friendly, right? So that's Hobbes's point, that international conflicts can, in fact, be resolved to everyone's satisfaction, notwithstanding the atrocities and all of this. And we have lots of historical examples, but civil wars, he said, are worse, because even when civil wars are solved or resolved, then you have this big problem that the scars never really heal. Okay, Abdullah, in modern days, you could say USA and Germany as examples of what? I would say in modern days, USA and Germany are examples of the thesis that I'm trying to illustrate, that we were terrible enemies during World War II, but very good friends now. Racial tensions in the USA, right? I mean, this is a Hobbes is a very good illustration of what Hobbes is trying to say. Look, we've had a culture war and a gender war in this country that's been going on for 50 years. Okay, the so-called culture wars and gender wars, these are forms of civil war. And sometimes they have violent manifestations, at other times less violent manifestations. But there have been tensions in this country in virtually my whole living memory, and they've never been resolved. And there's civil tensions, right? It's all within the historical and political context of the USA. And indeed, as David says, we still have after effects of the American Civil War. The North and the South still are different in a certain way. And Dubois said that the Civil War never really ended. And that's even true. Dubois wrote much earlier, right? Much earlier in the last century, but also true that Civil War has not really ended. If you look at the contentious issues of Civil War monuments and, you know, lately the tearing down of certain monuments and so forth, you could see that's still an outgrowth of the American Civil War, after effect of the American Civil War. Yeah. So basically, I want you to understand what Hobbes would say, that because it's a civil war, it's much more difficult to resolve. Notwithstanding whatever the particular causes are of a civil war, it's going to be worse than an international war because it just goes on and can erupt again at almost any time. So he wanted to solve civil war. Okay, that was his main goal. Okay, are we clear about that? That's a big political statement, but I want you to understand that the Leviathan was written primarily in order to address this problem and to find a way to restore civil peace to a country that had been torn apart by civil war. So that's a very important project. And that's the main project of Leviathan. Now let's go to the philosophy, because I want to now come back. We're going to start first things first. We'll start with first principles. And I want to share a screen with you just to illustrate a little bit of context once again about Hobbes's particular time. And I have a few notes. This is in your folder, but just to remind you of where we're at. We talked a bit about Galileo and his achievement with removing physics and astronomy, basically as branches of theology. You could say that the experiments that Galileo did with physics and astronomy were for the sake of reliable scientific knowledge and not to pay lip service to any received religious doctrine. And that's why he came into conflict with the church, because he inadvertently contradicted some of their dogmas. Descartes removed scientific method as a branch of theology. Descartes got into a bit of trouble too. Not as much as Galileo and Hobbes and Spinoza, but he got into trouble too. We looked at his Meditations, but his other important book on method is really the beginnings of the formulation of what we might today call scientific method. And so he also wanted that to be done on the basis of reason, not the basis of faith, right? Although, of course, he himself was religious, as were they all, but they ended up coming into conflict with received religious authorities. Spinoza, we're not going to look at him much, but he was a contemporary. They were all aware of each other. And Spinoza removed philosophy itself as a branch of theology, got himself into considerable trouble, and ended up being excommunicated by the Jewish community in Amsterdam because he was basically a heretic from their point of view. Hobbes got into as much trouble as all of them, maybe a little more, because Hobbes was attempting to remove politics itself as a branch of theology, in what we today call separation of church and state, and the establishment of a secular state. And Hobbes said he believed in God, but he didn't believe that priests should be running governments. That's basically one of his theses, okay? He thinks that governments have to be secular and that religion is a separate matter. So you can begin to understand that also would have brought him into huge trouble. In fact, he could have been put to death for some of his heretical views, and we'll look at them shortly. Meanwhile, I want to return to something I mentioned early on at the outset of this section, namely ethical egoism, which is the thesis that each person should act in his or her own self-interest. So that's of course, an ethical claim. Just saying that you should do whatever it is that you think is in your best interest, and so should I, and so should all of us. Then you can imagine what happens if we have a society full of ethical egoists. It's a recipe for conflict, because what's in my best interest might not be in yours, and so forth. You know, if it's in my best interest to exploit you, that's obviously not in your best interest to be exploited, and so forth. So this looks like a recipe for conflict, if not anarchy. But that's why you won't find too many ethical egoists out there. But psychological egoism is the thesis that we are all born ethical egoists. That ethical egoism is like a plank of human nature. That's the thesis of psychological egoism. And we can't help it. This is how we're made, or how we're evolved. So Hobbes believed that to be the case. That's Hobbes' analysis, that we are basically psychological egoists. And so we have to work very hard to create some kind of civil harmony and to knit together a social fabric and to maintain a stable political order, because Hobbes thinks it's not in our nature to do this. Our nature is rather to be self-interested and to inevitably come into conflict with one another at all levels, within the family, within the community, within the polity. And that's what Hobbes sees. So we're going to get from this a very interesting view of ethics. It's called nominalism. As we'll see in his own words, he believes that good and bad are only names for things we like or dislike. He's going to completely reject Plato and Aristotle, not surprisingly. I'm sure by now you've seen enough to know that every philosopher who comes next is always willing to reject the philosophers who came earlier and say, oh, I have a better idea, right? And that's how philosophy goes. But nominalism is a word that comes from the French, nom meaning name. So he says that if we call something good, it doesn't mean that it has any inherent goodness. It just means that we like it. Okay. So you call something good because you like it. If someone says, did you read any good books lately? You're going to name some book you liked. Obviously. Did you eat in any good restaurants lately? Well, you're going to name one you like. And similarly, bad is just a name for things that you dislike. Huh? That's nominalism. And as I say, his main task, though, will be to resolve the problem of civil war. So a few big steps to there, but we're gonna go through some key points now in the Leviathan. All right, I'll say one more thing to you, and I'll take any questions that may so far have arisen. Hobbes is controversial, I mean, no question, but I think you'll be persuaded, even if you don't like what he has to say about human nature, and some of you will, some of you won't, and that's normal. But I think you'll have to grant the man some due. You have to give the devil his due and say, well, his observations are not entirely wrong or inaccurate. Even if we don't like what he's telling us about ourselves, we are bound to admit in certain respect that he was not entirely wrong in what he has to say. And of course, everything's debatable in philosophy. And so is Hobbes. But maybe you can see from my own presentation thus far, I'm rather well disposed toward him. Doesn't mean you have to be at all. But I happen to agree with a lot of what he says, and I've studied him now for many years. So I just want to let you know that if you're interested in looking more at his life, I recently actually published a piece in the Times Literary Supplement. I was invited to write about him, and I'll just share the link with you in case you're interested. The Times, this is the London Times, and they came up with a really great series, I think, a great series. It's called Footnotes to Plato. And the reason it's called Footnotes to Plato is that You remember what I said about Alfred North Whitehead, right? Who said that the history of Western philosophy is largely 2,000 years of footnotes to Plato. You remember that? So the Times Literary Supplement, which is a very erudite publication, not scholarly, but it's really for public intellectuals, they came out with a series of biographies or historical essays on many important philosophers. It's a work in progress, and not all these philosophers are up there yet. But they invited me to do one on Hobbes, and I was really honored to do one on Hobbes. So I'll just share, if I can manage to pull this up. There it is. If you're interested in learning about his life, you know, a little bit about his life and times and the trouble he got into and why, then this would be a good thing. And if I can manage to get the actual link, there it is. So it's called Footnotes to Plato. That's the series. And so if you just Google Footnotes to Plato and Thomas Hobbes, you'll pull up the essay. Please don't expect this to be scholarly. I'm now violating everything I told you guys to do because it is an essay, but it's a non-scholarly essay, so it has no footnotes. I've done much more scholarly things with this material in a book chapter that is fully footnoted, but this is for essentially a newspaper. So it's an article without footnotes, but you might, that's an oil painting of him. So anyway, if you want to read an essay about his life and times and the kinds of trouble he got into and why he's still relevant to us, I certainly invite you to have a look at that. And online, you'll find a plethora of information about him. He's a very important and influential philosopher. So there's no shortage of material about Hobbes if you want to dig a little more into his life. Okay, any questions so far before we dive into the Leviathan? Any questions or comments? Yes, go ahead.
First of all, congratulations on your article. That's really cool.
Oh, thank you.
I also, for ethical egoism, is that we should act in our own self-interest, or that's just our nature?
Psychological egoism says it's our nature. Ethical egoism says we should each act according to our own self-interest.
Okay, how does he reconcile that?
With what? You know,
with the fact that, like, if we all act in our own self-interest, the world would just be completely chaotic.
Well, he looked out at the world. He looked out at the world and said, it's completely chaotic. Why is that? You know, it's the other way around. He's an empiricist, right? He's a British empiricist. He looked at the world. He saw at every level. He saw conflict. He saw conflicts in families. He saw conflicts in society. He saw political conflicts, both civil and international. And he said the human being is a conflicted animal. We're very conflicted. And he wanted to understand why. He was trying to explain his observations. He wasn't prejudging us at all. He thought very long and hard. The Leviathan, at which we're going to look in a minute, was written in exile. He took the side of the king in this civil war, by the way. He believed that we really need authority. If we don't have a strong government, he said, people are always going to end up in conflict and it's going to hurt everybody and prevent us from engaging in what he called a commonwealth, which is a peaceful and prosperous society. He said strong government is really, for his, you know, from his perspective, the best way to achieve that. So when the Civil War broke out in England, he actually sided with the king. And he was at the time in fear of his life because Parliament and the forces of Parliament that were arrayed against the king were actually prosecuting and persecuting royalists, as the king's supporters were called. And some of them were even being accused of Hobbesism. So Hobbes's philosophy got an A. Oh, if you're in favor of the king, you're a Hobbesist. And some of them were being hanged for being Hobbesists. So Hobbes took the hint and he fled England in fear of his life. And he ended up in Paris with the court because the king, King Charles, sent his wife and his son, Prince Charles II, over there with the court while the war was raging in England. And Hobbes ended up tutoring Prince Charles. Hobbes was a very respected scholar. He was a great scholar from middle-class origins. Note well, he came from very humble middle-class origins, but because he performed so well in school, he studied at Oxford on a scholarship, and he was a great scholar. And so he eventually was respected enough to be promoted to be a tutor to very powerful ruling families, much like Seneca achieved in Rome. But in any case, Hobbes found himself in exile with the English court, and he was hired to tutor Prince Charles II in mathematics, primarily in geometry and classics. And ironically, this is a great irony, he was not allowed to give political instruction to the son of the king whom he supported in the Civil War, but he was hired as a geometry teacher and maybe a classics teacher. And it was in this 11-year period of exile in Paris that he wrote the Leviathan, and he gave it to the prince as a gift. And then he was betrayed by the closet Catholics, who convinced the prince that it was really an apology for Cromwell, who was the leader of the parliamentarian forces. So he had to flee France and go back to England because he managed to antagonize everybody. You know, philosophers are often gauged by, you know, the importance of their ideas is often measured by just exactly how much antagonism they attract. Philosophers are people, as you've figured out by now, who like to swim against the current, who like to think for themselves and are not often just going to go along with what everybody believes, right? So that's why philosophers get into trouble. And sometimes the more important the philosopher is, the more trouble they manage to get into. And it's maybe not fun to be that philosopher, but I think that's honestly, they have the courage of their convictions. It's sort of a necessary thing. Okay, so they're the blueprint. Yeah, the blueprint for what? I'm not sure, Alejandra. The blueprint for getting into trouble, maybe.
So that his argument is that we should act in our own self-interest. Like it's more than just the observation.
No, his argument is it's because we're made to act in our own self-interest that we get into conflict. That's the problem.
Okay.
So how do we then go against our own natures in order to bring an orderly society out of this, right? That's his problem, okay? So I hope this is clear, yeah? Okay. He's trying to solve the problem. He's not trying to say, well, this is, you know, the problem can't be solved. He comes up with a solution. And it's called the social contract, by the way. I mean, it's now known as social contractarianism. And it's a very brilliant solution, in my view, but it's a little bit complicated. I don't want to go too far ahead. Let's go back. I gave you kind of an overview, and you can certainly find out as much as you want about Hobbes. But I think now the thing to do is to actually delve into Leviathan to see how Hobbes runs this thesis, all right? That we're psychological egoists, and this brings us into conflict. And in fact, it's a conflict potentially of everybody against everybody. It's worse than civil war. It ends up being almost anarchy if it goes that far. And we need to solve this problem in order to live in peace and security. He wants us to be able to live in peace and security. He's certainly not a fan of unending conflict, not at all. He wants people to have decent life, but we have to work very hard to achieve it, because having that kind of a life, being in what he calls a commonwealth, is going to entail escaping from this state of nature, as he terms our natural existence, in virtue of the kind of beings we are evolved to be or created to be. We get ourselves into lots of trouble. So he has to solve this problem. And his Leviathan is the proposed, not only the statement of our problem, but also his proposed solution, okay? It's his masterwork. Although he wrote 12 books, this one encapsulates the most systemic presentation of the various threads of his philosophy. We're going to start in chapter 6. You can read the whole thing if you want. It's quite a big book. You needn't do this. I've highlighted some extracts, as usual, that may help you. The Leviathan was... Leviathan means what? Does anybody know what Leviathan means? That's the name of the book. Does anybody know what it means?
A sea creature, professor?
Very good. Yes. I don't know who's speaking, but you're absolutely right.
Nicole, sorry.
Good for you, Nicole. Yeah, it's a Hebrew word, Leviathan. It means a sea creature, a giant sea creature. And he envisions the state, like the political state, as a giant creature, you know, with many, many parts who are the citizens and one head who is the sovereign. But that's the name for his picture of the state, Leviathan. Published, he completed it in 1651. So middle of the 17th century is when this appeared. So the main thing, we're going to start in chapter 6, and where he expresses this view that you know, the things that we love and hate things we love are things we desire. So we would use the word love. He's quite cynical, but also a kind of realist. He says when people say they love something, he says it means they desire it primarily in the first place. And of course, when we say we hate something, it means we're averse to it. I think that's a bit of a kind of a common sense usage of these words. But this argument about these words will lead him to this very important notion of ethical nominalism, okay? That good and evil are only names. And so whatsoever is the object of any man's appetite or desire, that is it which he, for his part, calleth good. So it's just a name you give to something you like, something you want, something you crave, right? You call it good. Why? Because you like it. And the object of his hate and aversion, evil. So if you dislike something or you're averse to something, you're going to say, oh, that's bad, or, you know, that's evil. Why? Because you don't like it. So in other words, it's totally subjective, isn't it? Yes? You with me?
Yes.
Totally subjective. Totally subjective.
Yes.
Whatever you like, you call good. And that might be something that someone else dislikes. So they're going to call it bad. Yeah? So our natural state, and this is really, he's saying, this is our nature. So in our natural state, it should be clear, we don't have anything like consensus on good or bad, because good and bad are only names. Only names for things we like and dislike, respectively. So immediately you could see the grounds for disagreement with people. Yes, and it's not just going to be on matters of taste, aesthetic matters. It's going to be on these very serious ethical matters, which eventually will translate into political matters, won't they? So if we don't like a leader or hate a leader, we're going to call him bad or evil. If we like a leader or love a leader, we're going to say, oh, this leader's good, right? It's a matter of subjective taste. And he'll see, he goes on to explain, these words are just used with relation to the person that uses them. In other words, it's completely subjective. And there's nothing simply and absolutely good or bad. Excuse me, nothing absolutely good or bad. So who's he contradicting when he says there's nothing absolutely good? There's no absolute good in the universe. Who's he contradicting?
God or the church, the Bible.
How about, yes, on a religious view, although he is religious and he's not talking about God now, because he believed in God, but he believed in a material God because he's a materialist. But which philosopher is he contradicting? Hint, we just looked at him. How about Plato? How about the pure form of good? Right? Hobbes says there's no such thing. There's no absolute good, nor for that matter is there absolute evil. Okay, are we at least clear about this? This is important, okay? Because you want to know or realize that Hobbes' view of ethics is that they're entirely subjective. All right? Are we clear about that? Yes, do I have a yes?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. All right. I'm trying to connect some dots for you. The book is more complicated, but I'm trying to connect some main dots, some primary dots, so that you'll understand where Hobbes' argument is going. He says the power, what is power? By power, Hobbes means your ability to get what you want, get what you call good. So Hobbes says it's nothing to do with your position or your wealth. Interestingly enough, your power is your ability to get what you think is good, to get what you like. So if you wake up in the morning and you're able to get what you like, then you're powerful. And if you wake up in the morning and you're not able to get what you like, Hobbes says you're not powerful. All right, so your power is your ability, your present means, to obtain some future apparent good. Why apparent? Because it's only something that appears to you as desirable, right? What's good is what you like. So if you are able to obtain something that you like, then Hobbes would say that you're powerful. And that's whether that good, that thing you like, is either inherent, meaning original, or instrumental. He's not going to care which kind of good it is. If it's something you want or like, whether it's something you like inherently, or something you like, you know, instrumentally, Hobbes would say, if you can get what you like, you're powerful, right? So please understand, when he uses these words, this is what they mean. He's very meticulous about defining his terms so that we don't misunderstand what he's going to say. And that's why I'm picking these words out, so you know when he says good, it refers to a label for something you like. And we know when he says power, it refers to your ability to get what you like. All right. This is very, very clear language and a very consistent use of language in Hobbes. All right. Now, chapter 11, quite important, because he's going to tell us something about what he thinks our human nature is. And he goes on. We are to consider that this felicity, felicity means continuous happiness. It's a word somehow that's dropped out of English. We don't use it much anymore today, although I think in Spanish, the root is still very much used, feliz, right? Meaning what? If you say, soy feliz, what are you saying?
I'm happy.
I'm happy, right. So it has something to do with happiness. And in English, we don't use it much, but it used to be a girl's name. Felicity was a very, very popular name at one time for girls. It means happiness, but it doesn't just mean a mood. It's this idea of eudaimonia. It's Aristotle's idea of a long kind of a string of fulfillment. And that's what Hobbes calls felicity. And he says that felicity is not in the repose of a mind satisfied. And he says there is no such utmost aim. So here he's rejecting Aristotle, finis ultimus, meaning the goal that we all strive for. Aristotle says we all want to be happy, right? Hobbes says you're never going to be happy. You're only going to have a bunch of successes or a bunch of failures getting what you want. You'll never be completely happy no matter what. So he's rejecting Aristotle. And he says, nor summum bonum, greatest good, as it's spoken of in the books of the old moral philosophers. Well, it's very clear who he means. When he talks about the old moral philosophers, he's talking about Plato and Aristotle. And in that paragraph, he's rejecting Aristotle's idea that we can achieve lasting happiness as an ultimate aim. Remember Aristotle? What's the ultimate aim? The thing we want for itself and for nothing else, right? He says that's a fiction. And also there's no greatest good. There's no pure form of good that illuminates all the others. So he's really rejecting both Plato and Aristotle. And he's going to give us a different view, completely different view. And in the first place, he says, I put for a general inclination of all mankind. This is a theory about everybody. I put for a general inclination of all mankind, a perpetual and restless desire of power after power that ceaseth only in death. So we're the kind of creature, says Hobbes, who never stops wanting things. Remember, your power is your ability to get what you want in a given moment, right? Or at a given time. So he says we always want something, no matter what. We're never satisfied. We're always going to want something else, no matter what we get or what we lose. So we have this restless desire, power after power. And he's doing this as an observer. If you look at little kids, don't they always want something?
If you look at grown people, they always want something.
Well, okay, you want to start with us? Yes, grown people always want something. And you know what? So do elderly people. Maybe their wants become more diminished as we grow older and perhaps less, more dependent on others. But if you go visit an elder care facility, everybody wants something in there, don't they? I mean, it's a rhetorical question. Of course they do. Their wants may be more limited as their powers wane. And I'm saying that little children want something too. All kids want something. Give them a new toy. How long are they going to play with it? So they get bored and they want something else. Isn't it so?
Exactly.
Well, that's what Hobbes is saying. All mankind, all of us, he says, we're the sort of creature that has a perpetual and restless desire for power after power. Remember what he means by power is getting what we want. And the only time we stop wanting things is when we're dead. Okay. That's basically his view of our motivational psychology on a day-to-day basis. Chapter 13 is the most contentious part of the whole book. It introduces a full-blown theory of human nature and the causes of conflict and poses the problem in the most general way that, of course, he'll go on to solve, namely the problem of civil war. But this is really about human nature and about our interactions with each other. And it's very surprising. And it starts off on a surprising note because he says, to begin with, we're actually quite equal. That is to say, there are, he says, inequalities in terms of somebody may be stronger in body or quicker of mind. I mean, obviously, there are some physical, you know, and let's say mental differences that were not all the same. But nonetheless, he says, when all is reckoned together, the difference between man and man is not so considerable. And what does that mean? He actually thinks we're made equal. We're born equal in a certain way. He says, because all of us can claim to ourselves any benefit to which another may not can pretend as well as he. What he's saying is that everybody has a hope of getting what they want out of life, more or less. So this is his view of equality. It's not the normal view that we're accustomed to. This is pre-civil rights. There was no such thing in Hobbes's day. They're coming out of a feudal system, and Parliament is just beginning to appropriate power from the monarchies. But this is a, you know, pre-revolutionary time, pre-democratic times. But he's still saying that people have more or less a hope when they get up in the morning of getting what they want. And that's something that makes us equal, not unequal. For as strength, as far as strength of body, he says, the weakest has strength enough to kill the strongest, either by secret machination or by confederacy with others. So the primary, this is very disputatious, the primary criterion of equality is that anybody can basically kill anybody else if they really want to. Even the so-called weakest can kill the strongest. How many people did it take to kill Julius Caesar? Caesar was a strong guy, right? Very courageous general, and you know, made himself an emperor, basically, of Rome. But he was assassinated. How many people did it take? Does anybody remember? Anybody know? Nobody had the courage to do it alone, but 9 of them stabbed him. Okay, they ganged up on him. And so that's what he's saying. Nobody's so strong they can't be taken down. All right? And he goes on to say this equality of ability, in other words, you know, you have a reasonable chance of getting what you want out of life. And because we all think this, we are going to come into conflict. That's a recipe for conflict. So for Hobbes, equality of hope in getting what we want is actually going to be one of the causes of conflict. Because if any two of us desire the same thing, which we can't share, we're going to become at least competitors, he says enemies. But basically, we're going to become competitors, if not enemies. So there are certain resources in life which you just simply can't share. If you're applying for a job, then two people can't get the job. You're going to be a competitor. If you're applying, you know, if you propose to somebody, you want to marry somebody, you know, they can only marry one person in most societies. So you're going to have a competitor. If you're trying to secure any resource that cannot be shared, then basically everybody else who wants that, who has hope of getting that, will become your competitor and maybe your enemy. So this equality of ability and equality of hope in getting what we want out of life will certainly at times bring us into conflict. And so there are 3 main causes of quarrel. And by quarrel, he means potentially violent quarrel, conflict. And there are 3 main causes of conflict, and it's in our nature, right? It's in our nature. This is all his assessment of our nature. First, competition, which he's mentioned, right? Second, diffidence. That's a word also we don't use much in English anymore. Does anybody want to guess what diffidence means?
Doesn't that mean lack of confidence?
Close, very close, not quite. But again, think of the Spanish root, fido or fidel. What does that mean? In Latin, we used to name our dogs Fido, right? We don't do that anymore, but dogs used to be named Fido because it means I trust, right? So diffidence is mistrust. So we are mutually mistrustful, okay? Diffidence means mistrust. And mistrust can bring people into conflict just as well as competition can. If you don't trust your neighbor and your neighbor doesn't trust you, you're likely going to end up in some kind of a conflict. This was the conflict of the Peloponnesian War. Hobbes, when the Civil War was on the horizon, actually translated Thucydides' great work on the Peloponnesian War. He translated it out of Greek and into English to warn his countrymen, because what his view and many historians would view the Peloponnesian War as a civil war, Athens and Sparta were city-states, but they were really part of the same larger identity in Hellenic civilization, the two leading states of Hellenic civilization. And so the Peloponnesian War between Athens and Sparta could be viewed as a civil war, which it was for Hobbes, and it destroyed both of them. There was no victor. That was really the beginning of the end of Hellenic civilization and really the beginning of Rome's emergence as a great power on the heels of, you know, the denouement of Hellene. And this is because of civil war. And Hobbes thought, again, it's a terrible thing. Have to avoid it. So diffidence can bring us into war. The very first sentence, the very first paragraph of Thucydides' history of the Peloponnesian War reflects this, and that's where Hobbes got it from. Thucydides says that it was mistrust of each other which drew them into war. Athens saw that Sparta was enlarging its army, and so they were worried because Sparta had a great army, and they began to enlarge their navy because Athens had a great navy. And Sparta saw that Athens was building up its navy, so they were worried. So they each got mistrustful of the other one, and they escalated. This caused a kind of an arms race. And that eventually drew them into war. It was mistrust, not any overt cause, but mistrust, diffidence, okay? And the third is glory. And by glory, he means reputation. If somebody insults you, if somebody offends you, if somebody says something you don't like about them, then that's immediately going to potentially cause a conflict and maybe a violent conflict. Yes, that's true of us today, as well as it was then. So these are the three main causes. And he discusses them a little bit more in detail. The first cause, we invade for gain. If we want to get hold of a resource before somebody else does, then we may preemptively try and grab it, okay? If we mistrust somebody, then we will try to essentially protect ourselves and defend ourselves against potential attacks by that person. So we need an army, we need a defense, we need a Second Amendment, we need whatever it is in case we're attacked. And the third one, namely glory, Hobbes says that people will, in fact, come to conflict for trifles. That word was used by Freud later to describe the same thing. A word, a smile, a different opinion, any other sign of undervalue, either direct in their persons or reflection in their kindred. In other words, disrespect, right? If you disrespect a person verbally or with a gesture, if you disrespect their folks, their kindred, their friends, their nation, their profession, their name, their religion, then immediately you can provoke them to conflict. Is it not so? Isn't it easy? Don't try this at home, but I'm just saying it's very easy, is it not, to provoke people? Absolutely. So these are the three main causes. And hereby it is manifest, he says, during the time we live without a common power, this is the solution to the problem, that we need a common power to keep us all in awe. What does awe mean? Anybody know? Any ideas? Very important word. Awe is a combination of fear and love. So we have the word awesome, which we use usually to describe something we like. Awesome is great, right? But awful is the opposite, right? We say awestruck. There are many words that have this root in English, certainly. And it's a biblical word, and it's a combination of fear and love. It's the relationship we're supposed to have with God. We're supposed to be in awe of God, and it means both love and fear. So Hobbes is saying we also need a political power that keeps us all in awe. And that's how to defuse all these conflicts. We need a common power. And if we don't have that, then we're going to be at war with each other. And this war, he says, is of every man against every man. It's chaos. It's anarchy because of these three things that never end: competition, diffidence, and glory. So it's a terrible thing. He goes on to say how bad it is when we have this state of basically not only a civil war, but even within that war, there are many other sub-conflicts going on, as we see in the U.S. It's not just two sides. There are many, many factions on each side as well. Any civil war is like this, every civil war. They said of the Spanish Civil War that there were easily, you could identify four or five different kinds of civil wars going on within that war. Most civil wars are like that. And he gives us a very famous utterance that in such a condition, when we're at in this kind of a situation with no common power to keep us all in awe, there's going to be no chance. Culture will not thrive. Commodities, you know, trade will not thrive. Building will not thrive because things are being destroyed. Knowledge, you know, there will be no account of time, no arts, no letters, no society. All the things we value as cultural entities will basically be diminished and consecrated to conflict. And worst of all, he says, worst of all, continual fear and danger of violent death, and the life of man solitary, poor, nasty, brutish, and short. That phrase has been repeated many, many times to describe as, you know, the life of humans when it's really bad, when we're in this kind of war. If you look at life expectancies, they range, you know, anywhere up to 80, but in war-torn countries, they're always, of course, going to be the shortest. And our lives will become solitary, poor, nasty, brutish, and short if we do not have a common power to keep us all in awe. We're all in danger of falling into that trap. So Hobbes immediately, because he's a great philosopher, he says, okay, I know you may not like this characterization of human nature. He says, okay. So he says, he asks us to conduct a thought experiment. And I'm asking you to conduct the same thought experiment. Let him therefore consider with himself, you consider with yourselves, when taking a journey, he arms himself and seeks to go well accompanied. In those days, let's say you were riding from one city to another or one town to another on horseback, you would be armed, right? You would have a pistol, you'd have a sword, you'd have a dagger, and you would also want to go in company of others, right? Why? Why would you want to do that? Even in peacetime, you would arm yourself and probably travel, you know, with some friends. Why would you do that?
Can we say that
because
is because like because we don't trust man, or because, and you could say that, yeah, for security,
basically. Sure, absolutely, personal security, because you don't trust, it's not that you don't trust everybody, but you know there are going to be robbers out there, right? They used to have highway robbers, right? And we still do, and now we call them state troopers, you know, they stop you for speeding. I'm just kidding. But basically, the state robs us, you know, in a lot of ways now. They've legalized it. But essentially, to be serious now, not to be too much of a, you know, an insurrectionist, I'm a law-abiding citizen when I think the laws are just. So let's just be on the record with that. But basically, we still are in danger, right? We our personal security is potentially in danger if we're not attentive to our environments, right? There may be people out there who'd be willing to victimize us. So we have to protect ourselves. This was as true in the 17th century as it is today. Second point, he says, when going to sleep, he locks his doors. Well, how many of you leave your doors open at night? How many of you leave your doors unlocked? I'm not hearing too many. I mean, most of you probably lock your doors, right? In Manhattan, they usually have like 6 locks on the door, you know? I mean, but this is, we all do this. We lock our doors. Why? Again, because we don't trust people we don't know who might take advantage of an unlocked door. So we lock our doors to protect ourselves from home, from everybody out there in general, right? And even when you're in your house, he says, you lock your chests. So you all, I'll bet, I mean, Hobbes would bet, and I would bet with him, that you all have some secret stash in your own house. You know, you all have some hiding place for your valuables or your, you know, your diary or your whatever it is you're stashing away, you know, whether it's in the sugar or the flour or in the freezer or whatever it is, you all have some hiding places, don't you? Okay. You know, you have stuff secreted away, even from the people you share your household with. And even this, says Hobbes, when he knows there'd be laws and public officers, we know there's laws. We know there are public officers armed to revenge all injuries, and we have law enforcement. So Hobbes is saying to you in this thought experiment, what opinion do you have exactly of your fellow subjects when you ride armed? He says, what opinion do you have of your fellow citizens when you lock your doors? And what opinion do you have even of your children, you know, or people working in your house when you lock your chests? Are you not accusing mankind by your actions as much as he does by his words? Of course you are, right? Of course you are. But here's the really interesting thing. And this is what immediately got the death sentence pronounced on him. What he says next is heresy, and a complete heresy. He says, yeah, we're accusing people by our actions when we arm ourselves and lock our doors and hide stuff away. You know, we are saying we're distrustful of others, right? But are we accusing people's nature in it? No, he says. Neither of us accuse man's nature in it. The desires and other passions of man are in themselves no sin. This is vitally important utterance. He's saying we are made by nature to be dangerous animals. We're absolutely self-interested. We label everything good that we like, everything bad that we dislike. All we want is to get stuff that we like and to avoid stuff we dislike. And that's how we are, and that's how we're made. But we're not sinful. This is not sinful. It's just how we're made, and we have to recognize it. So does anybody know who he's contradicting when he says the desires and other passions of man are in themselves no sin? This is one of the most heretical things. If you said this in 1651, as he did, you could be burned at the stake for being a heretic. Does anybody know who he's contradicting when he says we're not sinful by nature? We're certainly dangerous, but we're not sinful by nature. We're dangerous by nature, but not sinful by nature. Any ideas? He's contradicting the theory of original sin, or the doctrine, rather, of original sin. Okay, that's Augustine, who basically reinterpreted Eden and gave this to the Roman Church, primarily the Anglican Church also, that we're born sinful, right? Some of you must have heard that before. Maybe some of you were taught this. Were you not, that we're born sinful? Anybody? No?
Yeah, I remember a specific Biggie Smalls line that says that, but besides that.
Yes. So this is called original sin, the doctrine of original sin. I'm trying to open the chat room so I can type that in. It's not, for some reason, not allowing me to open the chat room. But basically, the doctrine of original sin maintains that we're born sinful. This is our nature, and that we can't help it. And Hobbes is saying, no. We are born dangerous, just like we would talk about sharks as potentially dangerous, or tigers as potentially dangerous, or poisonous snakes as potentially dangerous. But we don't call them sinful because they're born this way. They're made this way. They can't help themselves, right? And Hobbes says, guess what? Humans are self-regarding, and we're totally subjective in our likes and dislikes, and we're very prone to come into conflict with each other for a host of reasons. And so we're also dangerous animals. But that's how we're made. It's not a sin. It's just how we are. This is an amazing thing to be saying in the 17th century. And it got him into a lot of trouble. And of course, people were appalled because he's telling us something about ourselves that a lot of people don't want to hear, right? A lot of people want to think, oh, we're good. You know, we're born good. We're born innocent. We're all of this stuff. If you watch children in a playground without supervision, you might come around to seeing that Hobbes is partly right about us, maybe not wholly. Okay, so he's saying that what we need are laws, and the only way to rein ourselves in, the only way to rein in these dangerous passions that bring us into conflict will be to have a central authority, what he calls a common power, to make laws that we will need to obey. And then we can basically stop all of this dangerous, violent, quarrelsome behavior. Okay, and so understand that this is all called. I'm gonna try and stop this share, and maybe I can get the chat room back. Here it is. Yes. So he repudiates. He is saying, he repudiates. Right. He rejects the doctrine of original sin, and that's Saint Augustine's doctrine. That's a mainstay to this day of church doctrine. He's saying, no, we're not sinful. We're just dangerous. We're just a dangerous piece of work. It's not sin. And he also proposes, therefore, without a common power, this so-called common power to keep law and order, without a common power, we are in what has come to be known. We are in a, it's named after him, Hobbesian state of nature. This is, in other words, how nature makes us, right? State of nature. And this is what our problem is, that we're born almost into this state of nature, and we need to find a way to escape from it. Okay, we're in a state of nature. We're all going to be dangerous. We're all going to be at war with each other more or less on a continuous basis or an intermittent basis. I misspelled Hobbesian. Let me go back there. No, too late. Okay, I misspelled it. It's Hobbesian, not Hobbesian. Okay, not Hobbesian, Hobbesian. And we need a central power, a common power to keep us all in awe. So we will keep ourselves in check, basically, and respect law and not be such dangerous predators as we are essentially made to be by nature. So if you want a good allegory of the state of nature, have any of you read Golding's fable, Lord of the Flies? I bet some of you have still studied this. Lord of the Flies. Any of you studied that? Yeah, a bunch of you have, a long time ago. Okay. Oh, so they're still teaching that. So you know the story. It's a bunch of, so yeah, great book. Why? Because it shows us exactly what Hobbes' thesis is. It shows us that you have a bunch of so-called civilized, well-mannered, well-brought-up children, right, who end up shipwrecked or anyway stranded on a desert island, bereft of any adult authority. So with no power to keep them all in awe, what happens? They degenerate into a state of savagery. Basically, they become very dangerous. And the veneer of civilization wears off very quickly. There have been two versions of this film. The second one, made in the 70s, the director said famously in an interview, he thought he would have a problem getting these children to revert to this Hobbesian state of nature since they were so well brought up. He said it would, you know, be a problem to get them to lose their manners. And he said it shocked him. He said the whole process could have unfolded over a long weekend. It was surprisingly easy to get these children to misbehave and to go back to this, you know, state of basically a Hobbesian state of nature, state of savagery. And this is how we are. So civilization for Hobbes is a kind of a thin veneer over that state. The person who takes most exception to this is Rousseau. And when Rousseau is so appalled by Hobbes that he can't, Dunkirk, yes, the circumstances are different. Okay, so as Arnicello is saying, I'm glad this is provoking a lot of thought. And essentially, Rousseau took the opposite view. That human nature, he called us the noble savage, right? That's Rousseau's view, that we're born good and innocent and pure and civilization corrupts us. So Rousseau is regarded as the spiritual father of the French Revolution, and that you have to basically overthrow governments in order to regain this noble savage nature the noble savage meaning good and pure and nonviolent. Most of the anthropological and archaeological evidence on the record suggests that Hobbes was right and Rousseau wrong about human nature. But in any case, that's a much longer debate. And Harvard psychologist Steven Pinker has written a beautiful book about this called The Blank Slate. If anyone's interested in this, The Blank Slate, it's this work by Pinker, which illustrates this debate between Hobbes and Rousseau with, 200 years of science that's followed and tells us that human nature is much more like, unfortunately, like what Hobbes is portraying than it is what Rousseau wanted it to be. Can't we be born neutral? Well, that would be Aristotle's view, Ahmed, right? Good question. Like that we're creatures of habit, yes? And that we turn out to be virtuous or vicious according to the habits, right? That would be Aristotle's view, right? Remember, Plato's view is that we're born basically with the virtues innate, but ignorant of them. So each one of these philosophers has a different view about human nature. Hobbes is just telling us something about ourselves, which is maybe a little less flattering, right? A little bit lower, a lot less flattering. So let's now go to, in the remaining time, which is very little today, we've covered a lot of ground. I want to just go over how we get out of it. On next day with my group, we're going to, in detail, look at Hobbes' solution to the problem, which is how we get into a commonwealth, what he called a commonwealth, which is a group of people who are more or less aligned to have a common purpose and to live more or less in peace and prosperity with each other. And that word commonwealth can be used to describe either a collection of independent sovereign states that agree to cooperate, like the British Commonwealth. Yeah, the legacy of the empire is the commonwealth. There are more than 50 states, which are sovereign states, but they all cooperate culturally, economically, in this commonwealth. And some of our American states are defined as commonwealths. Virginia, Kentucky, Massachusetts. If you drive on the highway, you'll see a sign, and welcome to the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. It's meant to be an association, a cooperative association, of people. It has that connotation. So how do we get out of a state of nature into a commonwealth is Hobbes' problem. But in a state of nature, which is this war of all against all, that there is no injustice. You know, the law of the jungle, there's no injustice in the jungle. Whatever happens, happens, right? It's might is right. And we can't talk about it being unjust that tigers eat deer, you know, and that snakes envenomate their prey. It's not unjust that sharks tear their food to, you know, pieces before eating it. That's not unjust. It's just nature. And Hobbes says, when humans are in a state of nature, we can't talk about justice either. The notions of right, wrong, justice, injustice there have no place. Where there is no common power, again, we need that common power. We need a government in order to have laws. And if we don't have laws, we can't talk about justice and injustice. Force and fraud are in war the two cardinal virtues. Unfortunately, might is right in war, and deceiving your enemy is going to be an advantage for you. So the things that we normally condemn in civil life would be virtues in a state of nature. Ahmed, did you have a hand up?
Yes, Professor. I'm sorry. I'm a bit confused about the or part. So say, for example, I'm in awe of my boss. Does that mean that me and my boss will not be in conflict? Or does that just, is the word awe just relating to country powers? And also, like, if the United States is in awe of, say, Germany or North Korea, if they have fear and love for another country, does that mean they won't go to war with them?
No, countries are not in awe of each other. Countries are competitors. We'll come on to that on Thursday in my group, but you can take that up. Awe applies within a particular nation state, so people would be in awe of their leader, or in a company, you'd be in awe of your CEO. If your CEO cannot command authority, said in a different way, Ahmed, if your boss does not command authority and respect, then your boss may not be an effective boss. Okay? Because if your boss fails to command authority and respect, then people might want to take over. People might want to say, hey, let's get rid of this boss. He or she's not very good. Maybe I could do a better job, right? So it's going to end up being creating conditions whereby conflict can arise. Whereas if people are in awe, then they'll be more likely to be at peace with each other as well. So that's the role of awe. Awe does not apply in international relations. Should he be in awe of his wife? Wow, you guys are asking some really good questions. Well, I'll tell you, I know a lot of married men who are in awe of their wives. I mean, Emerson said that a wife has more power over her husband than the political leaders of a country, but that's a different story. Does it apply in relationships? No. What Hobbes wants, I think, in relationships is more of a social contract, and we'll come on to that next day, because that's his solution to the problem, all right? These are wonderful questions, but we're still getting ahead a little bit of the solution. He is going to give us a solution to get us out of a state of nature and into a commonwealth, and then we'll look at how this plays out in terms of one's relations with, let's say, a spouse, with one's relations to a boss, with one's relations to a head of state. We will look at that next day. But let's just finish the treatment of this chapter 13. And remember, in a state of nature, we can't really talk about injustice or justice because there are no laws. And also there's no propriety, no dominion, no minor vine. You know, there's no property. In a state of nature, what belongs to you is whatever you can get your hands on. Right? And until someone else takes it from you, there's no sense of propriety whatsoever. But there is good news. And this is what is also quite interesting in Hobbes. And it's our last point for today, that we do have some chance of escaping the state of nature. And the rest of the book is going to be devoted from chapter 15 on to explaining how we do this and actually proposing even legal measures by which we can do this. But the passions that incline us to peace, he says, are fear of death, desire of such things as are necessary to commodious living, and a hope by their industry to obtain them. So in other words, if we would prefer to live rather than die, we're going to try and find a peaceful solution. People who don't fear death are very dangerous, therefore, because if people don't fear death, they may well take their own lives in order to kill a lot of people. And that's dangerous to everybody. So fear of death is an important ingredient in actually wanting to live at peace with each other. Desire of such things as are necessary to commodious living. Commodious means comfortable. It means, a decent life, basically. A decent life, right? And we want to have a decent life. You could call it the American dream or something like that. So we want the things that will give us a decent life. And we also need to have hope. If people have no hope, they will also become dangerous. If you make people hopeless, if a regime is so brutal, on the other hand, or a state of nature is so brutal either way, that people become hopeless, they'll also be dangerous. But if we fear death, we want to live as well as long as possible, and if we want to have a decent life, and we have some hope that by applying ourselves, that we're going to be able to get the things that we want in life, then we should be able to agree on some articles of peace and get ourselves out of the state of nature. And this is the rest of his work. He's going to try to explain how to get us out of a state of nature into a commonwealth, okay? And that's the second part of Hobbes. So we will look more at these issues with my group, breakout group on Thursday, but I'll upload that lecture as usual. And also you will be looking in your breakout groups at Hobbes's solution to the problem and how do we basically get ourselves out of a state of nature. And his, in a word, or in two words rather, the solution is going to be what he calls social contractarianism. It's what we call the social contract. He's going to compel us really to make agreements with each other that we keep. And those agreements will also be enforced by the sovereign power, not needless to say. But in essence, if we get into agreements that we keep with each other, then we're going to be trustworthy. We're going to realize that cooperation is superior to competition, certainly better than deadly quarrels. And we will begin to cooperate and have a society that will be peaceful and on the whole, a cooperative and turn into a commodious place. But he will give us some very specific ways of achieving that. Okay, any final questions about Hobbes today? About what we've covered, okay? Don't ask me to solve the problem. I'm going to work on this with you on, next day. But about our nature, this is the main thing, to understand what kind of creatures he thinks we are. Ahmed says Batman begins with the release of fear, talks, and creating hopelessness. Yeah, hopelessness is a terrible thing. It makes people desperate. Okay, I see that you're all discussing other films and other characters in which you have seen this kind of thing manifest, and I'm that's fine. Remember, Hobbes wrote this a long time ago, but it's a view which continues to reappear in various societies and various periods in history, and perhaps in our own. So you're all talking about Batman. Okay, that's fine. I'm not up to speed on Batman. But if you see Hobbesian themes in Batman, that's fine. Yes, there's another question, please.
Can you repeat the point that you said that humans are like always seeking power, and the only way that they can achieve it or like is when like they're dead, like not achieve it, but like more like
rest
until right. Like they're dead.
Sure. Remember, Hobbes says power means for Hobbes not money and not position. Power is your ability to get what you want, right? That's Hobbes' definition. If you can get what you want on a given day, you're powerful. And so what Hobbes is saying is that we're all made to want things on a regular basis, and our wants are purely subjective, right? And the only time we stop wanting stuff is when we're dead, basically. So from the earliest days, babies want, food, right? Babies want sleep. Babies want, very basic things, but children want more complicated things, and adults want more complicated things. And as we get older, our wants perhaps diminish or not, as the case may be. But there's never a stage in life when we don't want anything, when we don't desire anything, right? That's what Hobbes is saying. We are very desirous creatures in our nature. Very desirous. So self-aggrandizement is human nature. And yes, absolutely. You could say self-aggrandizement. You could say ego. Yeah, babies are very powerful because they can make adults get up in the middle of the night to feed them, right? So, they're certainly very powerful. They control the whole house, They do. Okay. I'm glad Hobbes has got you thinking about this stuff. He certainly compels us to think in a perhaps a non-conventional way or a non-habitual way about human nature. But his analyses of conflict are certainly still accurate today in many respects. All right, and I'll leave it at that. I'll resume with the breakout group on Thursday, and you will resume looking at what. So how does he solve this problem? How does he get us all to cooperate since we're such self-regarding, self-aggrandizing creatures? How do we ever manage to cooperate? He'll illustrate ways in which we can do that in the rest of the book. Okay, I wish you all a very good day and a very good week. And I wish you also continued interest in Hobbes and seeing how he solves these problems that he's posed. All right. Have a good day, everybody. I'll see some of you Thursday. You're more than welcome, all. I'll see some of you Thursday, and I'll upload that lecture as well. And I look forward to seeing you all next week when we tackle, once again, a very different philosopher. All right, bye-bye for now.
Thank you, Professor.
You're more than welcome. Take care, everybody. I'll stop the recording now.
And, bye, Professor.
Yes, okay, bye-bye for now. See you all again soon.